by Greg Chipp, Director of Drug Policy Australia, who has been integral in piecing this event together, to say a few words. Please give a warm welcome to Greg Chipp.
Thank you, Nick, and well, thanks everyone for coming. This is the accumulation of 3 months planning for not just Drug Policy Australia, but for eight or ten, I believe it is, that keep on coming on board, supporting organisations, not to name drop, but the Australian Drug Foundation, thank you, Family for Drug Support with Tony Trimingham. I better stop because I won't remember everyone, but the support from the AOD fraternity is important to where I guess the drug policy reform movement is going, not just in this country but in the world. You people, and I'm addressing one of the greatest social justice issues of our time. And I really see there's no other way to put that. And the exciting thing is this year that we've had some exciting developments around the world, legalisation in a couple of jurisdictions, Canada particularly, the Portugal model, which is again a decriminalised drug model, which really epitomises that support, don't punish message of, you know, let's support people rather than punish them for drug offences. I have said this many times. Hello, I'm Greg, and I'm an addict. And that's 20 years ago when I was addicted to heroin, down and out. You know, life was hurting, bleeding. But I recovered with the support of family, of friends. And I think that's the point of the meeting here today, that we need to encourage other people out there that they can be supported and recover. We need to make policy changes, big picture policy changes, that don't stigmatise drug users, that they don't make it harder for people to seek help. You know, as an addict, one of the first things coming out you've got to do is face all the demeaning issues surrounding the drug use, and you've lost all the stereotypes. So, look, the AOD people know that. Another group, important group of people here tonight are the parents of people with drug problems. And again, I must say, I still feel some degree of guilt for the trauma I put my family through as an addict. You thrash around and hurt those that you love, and those that you love, it's hard to know. And Tony Trimingham, a little bit more about that, spending his entire, dedicating his life to people, families that have drug problems. Of interested people, it's an organisation called Drug Policy Australia. It's a registered charity and has the motto Facts Change Minds, which of course is totally incorrect. You know, it's emotions that change minds. But nonetheless, there we go. So, the constitution of Drug Policy Australia, we're a registered charity. The principal purpose of the company are to promote the prevention and control of diseases associated with the use of psychoactive substances through harm minimisation. The interesting thing about this charity is that we're an advocacy-only charity. Unlike the people working at the coalface that provide services, we in actual fact advocate for political and change. There's a new category of the Charities Act that allows people to do that. The directors, and I'm running out of time here, as I normally do, they're the directors. We've got lovely Tony Trimingham, who's been a patron, and then Professor Nick Croft, who I'm sure a lot of you will know. What we believe is that legally enforced abstinence is unrealistic, unhealthy and counterproductive in modern Australia, which is one of the greatest users of drugs in the world, as we know. We, as this is Drug Policy Australia, was in consultative status with the United Nations, and a massive job to do at the United Nations. The UN conventions have locked in the drug prohibition the world owes. It was an overreach of the American imperial reach at the end of the Second World War, the zenith of their power through the United Nations. There's never been unanimity in laws amongst the whole world as there has with the drug prohibition. And that's what we're trying to undo, and that's what we're working towards. Look, other speakers will give you some facts, so I certainly won't dwell on that, but the number is just phenomenal. 154,000 Australians arrested. I just ask you to picture, as we did at primary school, your hand in the shoulder of the person in front of you. That's stretching 75 kilometres from here to Geelong of people waiting to go into the legal system. The mad loss, the cost of that to the families is just astronomical, and I do implore us to think about it and see if we can find a better way. We'll move on to this bit here, but it is the point that prohibition is not the way of the world. It's only the last 40 or 50 years, and there are other ways to pursue it. A drug-free world for the UN nation is just sheer madness and, not a viable goal. Harm reduction, supporting people with drug problems is the only way forward, and that's where Drug Policy Australia as an advocacy charity does. Drawing to an end here, the point is we will have some tins coming around. We've got a fantastic prize here. This is a fundraising event. Drug Policy Australia is a registered tax deductible charity, as I said. We've got three lovely books. Helen Barnicle, who's written a book, was the woman imprisoned the longest time in Australia and had a child in prison and fought the system. Chasing the Scream by Johan Hari, you all know, and Drug Addiction by Dr. John Sherman, who's one of our directors. So we'll pass some tins around, $5, and you'll be able to, three tickets for three winners that'll win three books from every 100 tickets sold. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Greg. Our next speaker this evening is another Greg. Greg Denham, who has been actively involved in drug policy for over 25 years. Greg is a former police officer with local, national and international experience in harm reduction and has been a strong advocate for evidence-informed policy and practice. He's currently the executive officer of the Yarra Drug and Health Forum in Melbourne, and Greg has helped with the introduction of naloxone and needle and syringe dispensing machines, as well as being active in advocating for a medically supervised injecting centre in North Richmond. Greg's also worked with law enforcement in developing countries, including... Where were you most recently? I think you've been in two places this year.
You were in last year.
Last year.
I thought there was something that started this year as well.
No, Nigeria. Where did you get?
Nigeria.
So he's been everywhere, man. Of policies and practices that support needle exchange, methadone and condom programs to prevent the spread of HIV and other blood-borne viruses. Greg's also the representative of the US-based agency, now it's not law enforcement against prohibition anymore, it is law enforcement action partnerships now, which is a bit more of a positive name, I suppose. LEAP is an international group of police officers and ex-police officers and other members of the criminal justice system who speak out against the war on drugs and want to end drug prohibition. Please give a warm welcome to Greg Denham.
Okay, thanks. Well, I guess I'm the designated warm-up act. And being a cold evening in Melbourne, I thought I'd run a bit of an activity, and the activity is that I just want you all to stand, please. Can everybody stand? If you can stand, please stand. And I want you to sit down if you've taken a drug in the last couple of weeks. And that includes alcohol, tobacco, prescription drugs,
last hour
caffeine. Okay. One person's still standing, so that's the odd person out.
Liar.
She's unusual, because we live in a drug-taking society. We've been in a drug-taking society for a long time. In fact, most societies are drug-taking societies. And I've conducted that activity with police, with public servants, with community members all around the world. As Nick said, I've been very fortunate to travel quite a lot. And that activity always seems to sort of bring home the fact that drugs are part of our society. We've had drugs for a long time, and we will continue to use drugs. And in fact, I guess if we were around 100 years ago, we'd be talking about these types of drugs which were legal back then, heroin and cocaine, which was part of Coca-Cola. So maybe today, before we started, you know, we might have a drink of Coca-Cola mixed with a bit of cocaine, or we might go down to a pharmacy to get some heroin, or other types of substances which could be basically bought over the counter. So the interesting thing about drug policy was about 100 years ago, there was this backlash against, particularly against specific groups, minority groups in the community, particularly in the United States. The association of black men and cocaine use, and also the Chinese and opium use, and Latinos and cannabis use, marijuana use, caused a lot of moral panic in the United States, and a lot of laws started to be developed, particularly in the United States, around the banning of substances. And the banning of substances grew in popularity during last century. We had a number of international conventions, as Greg just mentioned, trying to stop the use of drugs, banning the supply, banning trafficking, banning the use of a whole range of substances. Of course, you had Prohibition in the United States. They wanted to ban everything. Nobody could have any fun. Drugs were off the agenda. So Richard Nixon, of course, started the war on drugs in about 1971. We probably had had war on drugs before then, but he certainly started to make it a political tool. He used it as a means to swing voters towards him. And he started the war on drugs with his statement about, you know, it's America's enemy, public enemy number one. But even he knew then, in fact he deliberately did it, because he wanted to have, you know, a focus on particular groups within society who he wanted to infiltrate. And one of his key advisors back in the early 70s, about 20 years ago, made a statement that it was all a lie. They were just lying about the war on drugs in terms of the drug use. It was all about the people that were using drugs. Just had policymakers had, you know, 60 or 70 years ago, you know, focused on Latinos, black men, opium-smoking Chinese, they did it again. And in fact, we go through this cycle all the time about focusing on the people that use drugs and not specifically about the drug itself. So we had the UNODC identify a number of problems associated with prohibition. And they've identified a number of concerns about what happens when you prohibit a drug. And one of the major concerns is the creation of a huge black market where people, criminals, etc., can get funding to do other unlawful activities. And this is one of my favourite photographs. So I think it really sums up the war on drugs quite well, you know, in terms of opium production. In fact, there was a recent report where the United States activity in Afghanistan over the last 8 or 9 years had not had one or not made any difference in terms of the production of opium over that time. In fact, it's increased in the last 8 or 9 years, even though the United States has increased its activity in trying to remove the opium poppies. Greg mentioned this before, a drug-free world, we can do it. What does that mean? Well, it means it's totally unrealistic, of course, but it means that people like this man, Duterte, in the Philippines, can carry out his war on drugs, basically murdering indiscriminately people who may or may not be associated with the drug market. It means in places like Bangladesh, more recently, there are extrajudicial killings by certain squads, and this, again, has been identified as a political move to rid the government of political opposition. We have in Australia, we have police in New South Wales stopping people going to a music festival because they have been tested, the drug dogs have indicated that they may have a drug on them. And even if they don't, they're being excluded from music festivals. How do we measure success? Do we keep measuring success in terms of police activity purely based on seizures? You know, I've been involved in policing for over 25, 30 years, and if I had a dollar for every time police have got up and said, this is going to make a huge dent in the drug market, I'd be very rich by now. Very, very rich. All that happens is the price goes up, the purity goes down, and there's a displacement effect to another drug. So who benefits from prohibition in the war on drugs? There are many people, many organisations that benefit. I was a police officer for a long time. Police benefit through resources, through powers, through promotion, right? So we need to look at this. We need to identify who is actually benefiting from prohibition. Drug traffickers benefit from prohibition. They make lots of money. And they do other unlawful things. Okay, so I haven't got much time left, but just quickly, the international movement is swinging towards other types of approaches towards dealing with drug issues. I was in this room in 2010, when a guy called Ethan Nadelman spoke, from the Drug Policy Alliance in America. He said then, in 2010, in this room, that the international mood was changing, that things were progressing, that we were going to see significant change, and we have, particularly in the United States, in places like Canada, for example, which is going to legalise cannabis. All right, we've had a number of key statements from key organisations, World Health Organisation, talking about decriminalisation, Kofi Annan, former UN Secretary General, talking about the need to adopt a new approach towards drug policy. More recently, we've had police in Australia, retired police such as Ken Lay, saying we cannot arrest our way out of this situation. Mick Palmer saying we need to try different approaches, we need to try different ways. And finally, Mick Palmer saying it's time the community and its leaders had the courage to look at this issue with fresh eyes. So you're the community, you're looking it through fresh eyes. Please, you know, take some action, do, you know, work with the rest of us in terms of developing a new approach towards drugs. And let's support, don't punish. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg Denham. Sorry, his phone started talking at me. I think it heard him up on stage and went, miss him. Our next speaker this evening is Steph Tzanetis. Steph is the coordinator of Harm Reduction Victoria's Dancewize program, a nightlife and music festival harm reduction service offering peer education and support. Steph oversees the extensive network of Dancewize volunteers and regularly collaborates with festival organisers, venue owners, medical teams, law enforcement and policymakers to ensure partygoers have access to a safe space and non-judgmental drug education and support should they require it. Steph also volunteers with the Community Law Centre and is a leading advocate for compassionate care, otherwise known as psychedelic care, I think. pill testing services as well, having worked with overseas harm reduction services such as Cosmicare in Portugal and Dance Safe in the US, which, by the way, they stole from Australia, from Rave Safe Dance. Well, it's a bit of a story, but we were first. In the US, and also as a member of the Stay Safe Initiative, which recently conducted a successful pill testing trial at the Groove in the Move Festival a couple of months back, and then last week you would have seen, if you're following the media, the report that came out about that, and it was all pretty much good news. Steph has also been a major collaborator in the University of Melbourne Student Union's exploration of a harm reduction and pill testing service for students, bringing her experience in practical on-the-ground harm reduction and her legal and policy expertise to many areas of the drug law reform movement. Please give a warm welcome to Steph.
Thank you, Nathan. Well, Support Don't Punish is a global campaign that began in 2012. It's the community reclaiming the 26th of June, which the UN Odyssey has named the International Day Against Drug Abuse and Illicit Trafficking, and it's marred by the extrajudicial killings of people who use drugs. Support Don't Punish. The message is concise, but vulnerable to misinterpretation. What does it mean to support? In Australia, according to our best data, 8.5 million people have used an illicit drug in their lifetime, and 15% have done so in the past 12 months. 8.5 million Australians don't deserve to be punished by being criminalised, nor do they deserve to be subjected to unnecessary health interventions. We must be clear, to show support does not mean to overtake, to assert that doctor knows best, to pathologise all drug use. For the small percentage of people who do use drugs and do need a health intervention, we support them by advocating for treatment options to be made available and for such interventions to be delivered without stigmatisation. Support Don't Punish is a refreshed call cry echoing the self-empowerment movement that emerged in the 1980s. A movement from which we're grateful for the Denver Principles by the community collective People with AIDS. While being open about their positive status, PWA refused to be non-consensually labelled victims or patients subjected to a social death. They stood up and asserted nothing about us without us. This message was reaffirmed in 1986 with the Ottawa Charter of Health Promotion. What is health promotion? It has caused some semantic confusion, and some argue it essentially means public health. At its essence, health promotion comes from a place of understanding that health exists in a social context. If you want an expanded understanding of what it means to say support, don't punish, look to the map offered by health promotion. The core support strategies that health promotion offers are enable, mediate, advocate. Many of us here do health promotion work. In my role with Harm Reduction Victoria, I coordinate the Dancewize program, which delivers health promotion and harm reduction education and support outreach services at music events and festivals. Our back of house, where Dancewize team members provide support for intoxicated people, is non-judgmental, comes from a place of lived experience, and relieves the pressure from on-site health providers, and in doing so, reduces the potential burden on public health, among other examples causally linked to social burden. Through this service, Dancewize crew may have the opportunity to provide an education intervention or referral, but this depends on the residual capacity of the intoxicated person. It's a service we're honoured and humbled to provide to our peers, but this is an example of the ambulance being at the bottom of the cliff. Compare this to Dancewize front of house, where we do educational brief interventions with partygoers that might be stopping by to grab sunscreen or other free health supplies. This contact allows for an exchange with more receptive peers. But under this prohibitionist regime, this is still an example of the ambulance being at the bottom of the cliff. But running with this analogy, maybe it's a cliff with a less treacherous overhang. Dancewize was also represented on Harm Reduction Australia's Safety Testing Advisory Service at Festivals and Events Consortium, or the Stay Safe Consortium. During April's pilot in Canberra, two of the 83 samples were found to be toxic and potentially fatal. While the nature of this harm reduction intervention is neatly packaged, pill testing as a one-off at a festival met with a minority of vehement and overtly moralized opposition is still too ad hoc to properly demonstrate the full health benefits such innovations can provide. In order to support people who use drugs in a meaningful way, we must roll out evidence-based health promotion and harm reduction strategies to scale. And the people whose lives are affected most must be leaders in the movement at every level. There's at least 8.5 million people in Australia who fit this bill, but fear of punishment keeps many silent. We're fortunate here in Victoria because we have the opportunity to enable, to mediate, and advocate for a philosophical and systemic shift in our drug policies, guided by the Comprehensive Drug Policy Reform Parliamentary Inquiry Report. A report made not with just bipartisan, but multi-party support, and one that makes it clear, drug use is a health issue, not a criminal one. And remember what we know from health promotion, is health must be understood in a social context, not simply as a matter of biology or psychology. How do we do this? Yes, the parliamentary report offers a stem and leaf guide, and appointing an independent advisory council is a good starting point. I would like to offer a more simple first step. It's more like correcting an error or an anomaly. Victoria is one of only two jurisdictions in Australia where use, that is admitting to having ever used a drug, is a standalone offence. We're not talking about being intoxicated in public or in possession of any kind of contraband, but merely admitting use retrospectively. This is a crime in Victoria. If we repealed Section 75 of the Drugs, Poisons and Controlled Substances Act 1981, drug use would not be normalised or glorified, but the social climate would have the opportunity to shift, a safe space would be enabled, so people would be empowered to speak up earlier and seek support. Let me stress, the practical application of Section 75 is close to redundant. Here we have Victoria Police's stats from the past decade. You'll see people are really charged with this summary offence of use, and it's at a declining rate. Well, you might not quite be able to see it, but I'll read some of the figures out for you. In 2017, just over 2,000 use charges were laid in total, mostly as add-on offences connected with other conduct, and only 197 people were charged with use as a single offence. Those 197 people were likely to attend a treatment service, consuming resources better suited to those who are actually contemplating rehabilitation and want that support. But if a health intervention is forcibly imposed by the criminal justice system, it's less likely to be effective, even if it was ever necessary at all. And what about the disproportionate amount of harm that is done by becoming unnecessarily entangled in the criminal justice system? For the Victorians who recognise that health is promoted or demoted in its social context, who recognise that empowered communities with lived experience are well placed to enable, to mediate, and advocate for health promotion outcomes. If you agree with me in saying support, don't punish, then join me in urging our political leaders to repeal Section 75 immediately, so people who use drugs can have their identity and social standing restored once more and simply be known as people.
Again, if you do have a question during any of the speakers this evening, please submit them at supportdontpunish.org.au. We won't have much time for questions at the end, so please try and make them as succinct as possible. Our next speaker tonight is Nick Kent, kneeling beside me. He began as a student studying secondary teaching in the areas of languages and the humanities. Last year completed his master's through research at the Melbourne Graduate School of Education, where he undertook an analysis of historical and contemporary approaches to school drug education. After completing the grad dip in teaching in 2015, Nick was perplexed at the lack of teacher training around student drug use and the silence of the education system on this issue, as well as the slow pace of drug reform more broadly. Inspired to learn more and to advocate and research in this area further, Nick helped found Students for Sensible Drug Policy Australia in 2016, setting up their second chapter at the University of Melbourne. Nick has worked with several UniMelb student union administrations to implement pill testing and harm reduction services for students, and has travelled to numerous international conferences to represent Australian youth drug policy activism and his education research, in turn learning much about international drug policies and the communities they affect. Nick draws upon his experience in the nightclub and festival communities, his teaching and research experience, as well as his volunteer work with Dancewize as a peer educator, and was this year elected as the second president of Students for Sensible Drug Policy Australia. Please give a warm welcome to Nick.
Thank you very much, Nick, and thanks everyone for being here. So yeah, as Nick mentioned, my original background is in humanities teaching, so I was going to start with a little bit of a history lesson. Now Greg's already really awesomely covered a lot of the historical context around how we're in this situation that we're in, why we talk about drugs the way we do in society, and why we direct it and stigmatize it at certain groups. So I'm going to expand a little bit on that awesome introduction. So it's relatively common knowledge that the drug criminalization sort of system or framework began really into increments. So it started at the beginning of the 20th century and then really ramped up in the era of Richard Nixon. I just want to introduce a couple of interesting historical anecdotes that can add to this historical context. So as a teacher, that's really what I like to consider things within. I'm then just going to talk a little bit about how that's produced and reproduced stigma and prohibition all throughout the last two centuries, and then introduce a little bit of my experiences navigating that stigma and helping to start SSDP and where that's sort of taking us and our growing team. So I'm going to start with a quick little story. I wish I brought a picture of it. Unfortunately, I don't, sorry. But there's an alleyway in Fitzroy. I recently moved in around the corner. And there's an alleyway in Fitzroy where behind, from the back of the street entrance, you can see in old tarnished letters, manufacturing chemist. And so, you know, thinking about this and looking at the building, it's from about the 1880s, this alleyway and this building, all kinds of funky substances would have been brought along that alleyway and sold on the shopfront of Brunswick Street. So we can see here, it was common for heroin, cocaine, cannabis to be used in a range of tinctures for a range of health conditions, and were freely available to the general population. what I looked at in my thesis, what I really wanted to understand was where did this conversation of punishing people and judging them for that substance use or judging them for the intoxication, really in whatever form it takes, particularly in that era, where that came from. So I'm going to introduce a quick little bit of my research. A lot of it centres around the Women's Christian Temperance Union and the discourse changes that were happening at the start of the 19th century. And it's just really interesting to consider how that worked. Not to lay blame to the Women's Christian Temperance Union. They were suffragettes. They were progressive women. They were of their time. But they were very anti-drugs. The saying, lips that touch liquor shall not touch mine, might ring a bell with some of you. What they were doing was responding to massive social upheaval that was happening particularly through the West in the era of the Industrial Revolution, which was ripping apart traditional family structures. People were moving from the country into the city, and there was an increase or a perception of increase in substance abuse across the West. And that really took its form in the WCTU's education program. And so what happened in the United States, by 1901, every single state had a temperance scientific instruction run by the WCTU. Now, the textbooks of the time, I've looked at them, they're hilarious. It's if it wasn't so worrying. There'd be depictions of someone taking a sip of alcohol, of liquor, and their insides boiling up and all that kind of thing. And that's how drug education first began. And what I found really interesting is when you think generationally about how that worked, so the people who were receiving that education at the beginning of the 1900s in the United States, this all filtered through to Australia later, were the generation that voted for alcohol prohibition in the 1920s. Okay, so it's a really clear and obvious link between the education that people get in schools and the values that they're that are placed upon them in terms of how we think about drugs and then how drug policies were changed later on. Okay, so I think that's sort of part of my passion for drug education. I think it's just really interesting knowledge to know that this whole way that we think about drugs, as Greg and Steph both talked about, exists in a social context, and we need to sort of consider that as well. So another interesting facet of that time was that and Greg talked about this as well, the ways in which blame was placed upon certain populations who were deemed to be too hedonistic or too intoxicated, in the manner of the time, was often, sort of the colonial manner of the time, often directed at the lower classes and racial minorities. And that really played out all throughout the 20th century. And I'll build on what was said at the start in terms of Richard Nixon, when sort of phase two of the war on drugs was really ramped up in the context of the counterculture. I think the quote says something along the lines of, this is from Richard Nixon's chief of staff. He said, "We couldn't make it illegal to be black or to be against the war. But what we could do," and they were our biggest opponents in the 1972 election, "but what we could do is we could declare a war on drugs, and we could use the media and our social and political influence to teach the population or to get them to associate cannabis with hippies or over-associate cannabis with hippies and heroin with people of colour. And by working utilising that that message, we can disproportionately disrupt those communities. We can arrest their leaders, we can disrupt their meetings and all that kind of stuff." And that's exactly how the counterculture, or how I believe and what the evidence points to about how the counterculture was quashed. Just interesting to consider how it all came to be this way. That hasn't changed. You know, we still live in a society where support don't punish is a new message, or a message where we have a special evening over to discuss whether that's something that has merit or not. The default is that we punish people. We stigmatise them, we lock them up, we vilify them on the front page of the Herald Sun, and we judge them, and we cut them off from social and health and other support services. That's the norm that we find ourselves in. And that's the norm that I began navigating about 3 years ago, when I had a lot of strange feelings, like Nick said, in my course, when having had a whole bunch of experiences with drug-using communities, and was really perplexed when this course wanted me to be a teacher and wanted me to spend all day, every day with young people, and they didn't tell me anything about how to talk to them about drugs. And I was really, really concerned and weirded out by that. But also, I think it's just important, I mean, I was a different person back then, but the amount of internalized stigma I had about my right and my ability and the the efficacy of standing up and saying, hang on, there's a gap in the thing there, like, what's, let's look into that. I didn't have the confidence to do that. And it wasn't really until Rainbow Serpent Festival a couple of years ago when I saw a panel... I've run out of time. drug law reform in Australia and how we can get involved. And I met Penny Hill and Ash Blackwell, the founders of SSDP Australia. They immediately put me in touch with any researcher or academic or expert who could give me the confidence and the evidence base to pursue my research, and I went and did it. So that's really where SSDP Australia has come from over the last 2 years. And we exist to basically have a presence on campuses, to get the conversation going on campuses, and to encourage students, particularly to be able to just speak out about this if it's their personal experience, and also to give them the confidence to research it and to explore. There's still so much we don't know about drugs and humans and how we should interact. And we're really excited to be continuing that work. I was going to talk really briefly about the work that we've done with the University of Melbourne Student Union. This has been a whole bit of a quagmire. About 2 years ago, we received a unanimous vote from the Student Council at the University of Melbourne when I was leading the chapter there to provide reagent pill testing kits to students free of charge. This is important to remember that this is in the context of a Victorian state government which refuses to provide this service despite all the evidence. The thing is, though, student unions aren't really built to provide harm reduction services. Governments are barely even built to provide harm reduction services. So the process of actually getting that up on a University of Melbourne campus, quite a conservative institution at the end of the day, has been quite difficult. What I have here is some really interesting results, though, that just speak to the appetite for this kind of reform on campus. So a survey that was done in O Week last year. Would you access this service? 87% of students who were asked the question, keeping in mind that perhaps students who engage in this survey are maybe a little bit more likely to be using drugs, so consider that, but 87% of students said they'd access the service. Okay, that might be for themselves, that might be for one of their friends. The most crucial part, and this really justifies the harm reduction approach here, if test results indicated adulteration, would you consume or dispose of that substance? People have common sense. If you're told that a substance is going to give you an adverse health impact, overwhelmingly young people choose not to take it. So I'm really excited to continue working on this. I think that some context is, student unions are so not built for this. I've now dealt with 3 separately elected student administrations who have to start from ground zero every time they're elected, essentially. I'm really excited to be meeting with some people at the university in August next month, and I have probably some really firm commitments from this administration that I've had yet. And the appetite amongst the student population is there, and we're really not going to stop until this kind of service is available to University of Melbourne students. But now in my role as President of SSEP Australia, I'm really excited to be working to get this up to any campus and student union who will listen. Going forward, that's really what SSEP does. We're really excited. The momentum is immense. We're responding to... we don't have enough time to respond to all the interest from chapters that want to be set up. If there's anyone in the room who wants to join the team and help us, please do. So you can sign up at ssdp.org.au. Don't need to be a student to get involved. And we're really excited to be announcing our first chapter in WA at the Edith Cowan University. They actually threw a Support Don't Punish event last Sunday, and it was the new chapter, the new SSDP chapter in Perth that actually got that up. Interest in all states. I'm really excited to be working with Unharm on being accepted into the Progress Labs program, which is a not-for-profit startup accelerator program with the Australian Council for Social Services. And so SSDP has really been identified as a really promising student organisation in a really complex area of public policy that needs a really fresh perspective. Watch this space, because we're not going to stop.
You might have noticed it is a bit tight for time for our speakers this evening. 8 people or 9 people in 2 hours is very quick. Again, supportdontpunish.org.au for any questions. And now I'd like to invite our, 5th speaker this evening? Sam Biondo. Sam is the Executive Officer of the Victorian Alcohol and Drug Association, VAADA. It is the peak organisation representing AOD, that's Alcohol and Other Drug Service Providers in Victoria. Its stakeholders and members also include members of drug and alcohol related services, those affected by drug and alcohol misuse, members of the broader community and other related sectors. Sam was previously employed by Fitzroy Legal Service and has a background in education, social work and criminology. His principal work has involved social research, the production of educational materials and advocacy work. He has a keen interest in social justice, open and transparent systems of institutional accountability, and has been involved on a number of community sector boards, reference committees and non-government organisations. Sam, please give a warm welcome.
Thank you. And open, transparent systems are really important. And we all know what happens when you try and oppress things and you try and hide things and you try and stop things. It leads to a lot more damage and a lot more harm. I'd like to also acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land we're on tonight and the Aboriginal elders past and present, and to thank the organisers for having us here. VAADA is the organisation I work for, and it represents the treatment sector in Victoria. The views expressed tonight are mine, but many in our sector would totally agree with what I've got to say. And what we're talking about tonight, there's a lot of repetition and many of the same themes are being expressed. That's not because the presenters are boring or lazy, it's because about the, searching out new issues, it's because simply the logic and the evidence of how to reduce the harm from drugs to individuals and our community is very clear. There's a logic there and it's very clear. In essence, combating the drug problem through coercion and punishment continues to fail. And the end result of the current approach has so far been to create increasing harm, clandestine drug profits, corrupted political justice and police enforcement systems, and a stigmatised, marginalised and suffering mass of victims, often with little or nowhere to turn unless they're fortunate enough to be assisted. Now, I don't particularly have any slides up there, but you can visualise the things I'm saying. You can visualise the Victorian police drug squad being closed down and led to the courts and prosecuted, and a new wing being built at Port Phillip where they were housed. As it happens. And then started the spread of the amphetamine problem in the 2000s. They were selling the precursors to the underbelly crew. Now, these are aberrations, but it happened in the 20s, it's happened in the 50s, it's happened in the... Now, I won't go there. Of course, depending where you live in the world, this sort of approach brings destitution, imprisonment, summary execution, and this is what the fate is of many who face the cruel and often tyranny of logical and ill-conceived policies. And just as an aside, I should say that in the Australian context, the Victorian alcohol and drug system, despite its many shortcomings, does remain one of the more advanced and well-funded treatment systems in our country. Of course, this remains no consolation when you, because of the weight of demand and contradictory policies which we face in this country and in this state, individuals are required to wait days, weeks and months to access our treatment system. Yeah, there's been another, probably in the last couple of years, $300 million put into the Victorian system, and it's trying to piece together a functional system. And, you know, well done to the state government for doing this. In fact, that amount of money is the equivalent to what the federal government has put into the drug system, into supporting drugs treatment services across the nation in the last few years. And this is incredible. And there's quite some significant work that needs to be done at that federal level. Some of the essential problems facing our approach to reducing harm is that the policy frame and the web of social, political and legal policies dictating how we as a society respond to the complexity of drug use is fundamentally flawed. And in the process of denial built into this approach, like in so many other international jurisdictions which blindly follow the same failed oppressive measures, we create more complexity, more damage to individuals and our community than is necessary. The so-called war on drugs simply sets the preconditions for more harms, more deaths, more drug profits, ever-expanding policing and a burgeoning prison system, of which Victoria is a classic example. While Australia is not the worst proponent of this approach, a country still remains transfixed in a policy hiatus and is unable to make the necessary policy leap into pragmatic and evidence-based drug law reform. Fiona will speak on this later, but they've had a go at pragmatic policy and drug law reform. Hopefully we'll talk about it, won't we, Fiona?
Yeah, maybe.
There's a whole range of overseas developments to draw on that show a growing body of evidence about ways to minimise the harms, reduce death and morbidity, and keep the community safer. Some of these initiatives have been pursued in its jurisdictions as varied as the United States, believe it or not, Canada, Portugal, Iran, Peru, Mexico, Colombia, Germany, Netherlands, France, and many more. We as the Australian community need to seriously ask ourselves some basic questions. Why is it that Australia, we are seeing a burgeoning prison system full of those experiencing mental illness and other individuals associated with drug use? Why is it that for so long AOD treatment sector and harm reduction services have struggled to keep our heads above water to meet community demand? Why did it take so many coronial inquests to eventually get action to address the tragic loss of life in the North Richmond area? And to establish a real-time prescription monitoring system to monitor doctors' prescribing practices, not doctor shoppers. Only 20% of people attending getting their medications from doctors. I won't go on that one. Why is government failing in their responsibility to curtail the negative consequences of big alcohol, big pharma, and just for good measure, I thought I'd throw in today, big gaming and big food. We're going to have 20% less sugar in our drinks. There must be an election coming, and the cynical part of me says it's all about reducing taxation, but that's when you get hit with the tax. Given Australia in the 1980s, Victoria was a leader in the field of harm reduction and harm minimisation. Why has harm reduction clock virtually stopped? What's happened that's made us believe that complex issues might be fixed with simplistic measures such as harsh and more punitive laws, bigger prisons and Centrelink welfare cards? Why is it people on methadone have to continue paying for the dispensing fee and to be dependent on good grace prescribing practices of a small number of prescribing doctors rather than have their needs addressed as a right from some of those in the medical profession that would seemingly see their commitment to the Hippocratic Oath selectively or not primal extra? Essentially, when it comes to governments, 30 seconds. Essentially, when it comes to governments and policy direction in the AOD space, we have risk-averse government, easily frightened by the fear of backlash, preferring instead to maintain a policy void. We seem to be struck with a situation in Australia where evidence and pragmatic policy is not the preferred driver of change. And we criminalise illicit drug use, we drive the problem underground, we create huge profits, harm and end up in a criminal justice system that is totally ineffective. Finally, I want to leave you with a couple of thoughts. Why do we accept so many overdose deaths from legal and illegal substances in this country? The equivalent of 1.5 jumbo jets crash landing in Victoria every year. Count this across Australia, it's a disaster. How can we possibly see this sort of outcome as anything but the failure of our existing drug policy? And lastly, what would it be like if our community and government treated cancer patients the same way as they view people struggling with substance use issues? At the more acute end of the spectrum, aren't both parties entitled to a diagnosis, defined treatment, and a suite of interventions? Or is one person's life worth more than another?
Again, the conversation is online as well, hashtag support don't punish. There is another hashtag, which is hashtag Vic Drug Reform, where you can follow the conversation that has followed the drug law reform inquiry, which the report was recently tabled. Actually, it's not that recently anymore, a couple of months ago. I would next like to invite Dr. Stefan Gruenert up to the stage. He is a registered psychologist with more than 16 years' experience in the drug and alcohol sector as a clinician, researcher and manager. He is currently the CEO of Odyssey House Victoria and the president of the Victorian Alcohol and Other Drug Association. In the past, Stefan has worked as a senior counsellor in a range of settings and has conducted research on alcohol use, treatment effectiveness, intimacy, family work, and fathers. Stefan has... You've researched fathers? Oh, okay. I'm one as well. Yeah. Research later. Stefan has contributed to several resources for workers around parenting and family violence, and he regularly provides advice to government. In 2008, Stefan was invited to a meeting on global drug policy held at the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime in Vienna, and he received a Harvard Fellowship to attend Harvard Business School in 2014. He regularly delivers presentations at national and international conferences. Stefan has two young sons, is a junior cricket coach, and enjoys travel, renovating sports, gardening, cooking, and long walks on the beach. I think I stole that from the Odyssey website. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Stefan.
Thank you for that kind introduction and for the invitation to come and speak tonight. I too would like to acknowledge we meet on the traditional lands of the Wurundjeri people and pay my respects to elders past and present, and to also acknowledge that we've got a long way to go in closing the gap in Indigenous health, and just to be mindful of that tonight. Look, I could reiterate many of the points that have been made by other speakers and probably those after me, and but I won't. I guess it's nice to be in a room among my peers and people that share my values. I do hope, though, that there's some people in the audience tonight that may be sitting on the fence or are new to some of these arguments and may have had their views and thoughts shifted a little bit or challenged by some of what you've heard tonight as well. Look, we've obviously got a strong commitment to drug law reform, so I want to make that clear. You know, we all want to work towards approaches to policy that minimise harms and come about with more sensible, pragmatic, evidence-based policies rather than those that are populist, emotionally focused, moralistic, and things that essentially don't work. We know from the evidence and the research for many years that punishment simply doesn't work. There's no evidence that creating a more severe punishment ever acts as a deterrence. And yet governments and policy people continue to create harsher and harsher punishments, thinking that that will change behaviour. It doesn't. There's no evidence that increased policing powers, techniques have reduced supplies, although that, you know, we do know that the evidence... Okay. We do know that there is evidence that if you move away from punishment as approach, that drug use doesn't increase, and even if it did, occasionally what you see is increased use of drugs at a very low level, not particularly harmful level, but the problematic use goes down, and that surely is what we should be working towards. Look, I've been asked just to share a few thoughts around the treatment aspect of support. I want to acknowledge that support doesn't necessarily equal treatment. There's many people in the world who have overcome problems or used in all sorts of ways without harms that haven't required treatment, and I want to acknowledge all the work of peer support groups, the family members, friends, others that have helped people through their journeys. But treatment is certainly part of the system for those that need that and want that. We know treatment works for some people some of the time. That's the same whether you're talking about diabetes, cancer, or drug and alcohol issues. So this is just like another health and social issue. We know that the outcomes are better than prisons and the costs are less. And people need the right treatment at the right time. When we look at data around Australia nationally, we know that there's not enough funding. In fact, the most recent study suggests that there's around 200,000 people that want access to treatment that can't get it. And so simply put, we need to double the investment we have nationally in treatment, and that's about another $1.5 billion. If there was 200,000 people waiting for treatment in any other area of health, we wouldn't accept that. There would be an absolute outcry. And there's been a historic underinvestment. I acknowledge the support of the Victorian State Government recently, but we're coming off a low base, and there's still... is that stigma, that uneven distribution of health services, low investment in the workforce. People still find it hard to find their way into the workforce even when they want to contribute
in this way, and there's long delays. So without me talking too much any longer, I thought I'd show you a little bit of a short video that just introduces you to one type of treatment, which is a therapeutic community. This is a peer support treatment with all the health system wrapped around it, and introduce some of the voices of consumers or participants or community members who use that treatment into the conversation. In Melbourne, Victoria. For almost 40 years, we've been lucky enough to have this beautiful property here on the banks of the Yarra River to run our program from. A therapeutic community is a type of residential rehabilitation program, sometimes just called Resi Rehab or Rehab. It's a peer-led program, so our residents get involved in the day-to-day running of the program and they provide lots of support to each other. It's a recovery program from alcohol and other drug dependence, but we teach our residents lots of life skills and also how to better manage their emotions and their relationships. We've created this short video to give you a sense of what the place looks like and also how the program works. We hope you find it useful.
I had no idea what to expect coming to Odyssey Rehab. When I got here, I was given a buddy who explained how it worked and showed me around. We were placed in teams. That more or less follows a 9-to-5 workday. Made me feel I was a part of something. I work in the property development and maintenance team. It's our job to keep the buildings, the grounds in good shape. It's a big property, so there's always plenty to do and lots of great projects to be involved in. It keeps me busy, and I've learned about having a good work ethic too. Other people work in a business office to keep the facilities administration needs in order. They say it really helped them to get over any fears of using computers and that. Then there's a team in the kitchen. They prepare all the meals for the community and work with a qualified chef. It is amazing what they have learnt about professional food prep, and the food they prepare is fantastic. We also have a veggie garden and chooks. It's a great feeling when you know you're eating something you grew in the garden.
As a parent, I was a bit worried about how me and the kids would fit in here. The childcare centre is great though. It's run by qualified staff who understand what my son has been through. My 10-year-old daughter goes to the local primary school and loves it. The families here get a lot of support. It's a place where kids come first. There are a variety of bedrooms and spaces that can support a variety of different needs and cultures. We have rooms for families as well as couples and individuals. When I first came in, I couldn't believe how the residents run the house. It really is like a sort of village, but small enough to feel like a community and a home. An evening meeting for the whole community runs every night, and we have regular therapy groups and educational groups. There is lots on offer in terms of support, and it's really safe.
What surprised me, it's not all hard work. There's extra activities to do. It's not like you're on a holiday, but there are tennis courts and a volleyball area, indoor space for pool and table tennis and a gym. It's also got great parks around. I love the silent walks we do. It really starts to connect me with my surroundings. We're not wrapped in cotton wool and we all have to do our bit, but you learn new things, like how to listen to others, and that's okay to say how you feel and respect how others feel too. The staff are part of the place as well, just like us, we get heard here.
I'm a proud Aboriginal man. I was a bit worried about how it would fit in. The Aboriginal community is really supported here. There are Aboriginal staff and peers who know what we're going through, and they all have their own experience. We talk about closing the gap, and they get it. I feel like I can talk to someone who truly understands me.
I hope this video has given you a bit of an insight into what it's like for residents here at Odyssey House Victoria. Thanks for watching.
Thank you, Stefan, for your video. Our Our next speaker this evening is Fiona Patten. Fiona is the founder and leader of the Reason Party, formerly the Australian Sex Party, and a member of the Victorian Legislative Council for the Northern Metropolitan Region. She came to politics after 20 years of lobbying for the rights of organisations involved in the sexual rights movement, which included small businesses, sex workers, but also HIV and AIDS organisations, adult media and online anti-censorship groups. Her political career began as an AIDS educator with the ACT sex worker advocacy group WISE. She also held positions on the board of the AIDS Action Council as an Australian Federation of AIDS Organisations committee member and a member of the ACT Attorney General's Sex Industry Committee. Fiona set up and registered the Australian Sex Party in 2009 with a strong focus on civil libertarian and personal freedom issues. After being left frustrated and deeply disappointed with the lack of social change on censorship, drug law reform, euthanasia and gay marriage. In the 2014 Victoria state election, she won her seat at the Victorian Legislative Council, a balance of power position. Since her election to the upper house, she has successfully instigated landmark parliamentary inquiries into physician-assisted dying and also drug law reform with the Victorian Drug Law Reform Report, which was recently tabled. And has also introduced the bill, which was passed for, I don't know if it was quite your bill, there was a lot of amendments and all sorts of things, but you introduced it for the medically supervised injecting centre, and been a passionate and active voice in Parliament advocating for sensible drug law reform. Please warmly welcome you. Thank you.
Your voice is like a game show host tonight. See, if drugs don't work out for you,
game show.
Game show. Start of the century, I think it's yours. You're welcome, Nick. Nick used to work for me as well. I thank you so much for inviting me here this evening. Thank you to the wonderful previous speakers who really, I think, covered a lot of the reasons why we're all here today. I too would like to acknowledge that we are meeting on the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. And I would like to pay my respects to their elders, both past and present, and any emerging elders that are here with us today. I would also like to pay my respects to the pioneers of drug law reform in this room, and I can see a few of you here, and the people whose, I guess, whose personal tragedy has also been the reason that we fight today, and the reason that they fight, and the reason that I think we are actually making some real change. Support Don't Punish is such an important day, as many of the previous speakers have acknowledged. It's a kind of a protest to a really appalling day that's also on today. But I reflect back on my first Support Don't Punish, which we saw a quick picture where Nick and I decided to hand out pills, happy pills, of course, at down at Flinders Station. And we just put a pill in a little baggie and started saying, "Happy Wednesday, have a happy pill." And remarkably, most people took them. No questions. Sure. Occasionally someone said, "What's in that?" But not much. You know. And that was the point we were trying to, that was kind of the point, that people, take pills without knowing what is in them. And that was our campaign, was around pill testing. And it was so wonderful to see the pilot program that Steph mentioned at Grooving in the Moo earlier this year, that we finally got some testing up in Australia, and I hope that does lead to further testing, because we know it saves lives. And we know that what we saw in Canberra was that while we might have the most expensive drugs in Australia, in the world, we've got the most shit drugs in the world. It might take us half an hour to get delivery of cocaine, but I can bet your bottom dollar there's very little cocaine in it. So through law reform, I hope that we can see change. And also seeing Steph in your T-shirt tonight, the ACT UP T-shirt. And while I started in sex work and law reform, also my first volunteer gig in that area was working on a mobile needle exchange bus. And This was back in the 80s when Australia was good with good on drugs. Well, we're all good on drugs. Some of us better than others. But, however, this was when we were brave, and this was when we recognised that harm minimisation had to come at the forefront. And if we were going to stop people dying, if we were going to stop the spread of HIV and AIDS into nice people, we had to stop the nasty people, being the drug users and the sex workers and the homosexuals, from spreading it to the nice people. So we took up some wonderful harm minimisation programs, and we were one of the first countries in the world that really adopted needle exchange programs in a national and forward-thinking way. And I was very proud to be part of that. And I think we lost our way along there. But still, some of the remnants of that is that we have peer education in Australia in a way that very few other countries ever got. You know, we had funding for peer education. So that was my beginning. And it was part of the ACT UP, and it was part of, you know, if we don't act to save our own lives, no one else will. And then establishing the Australian Sex Party, which again was just a really, you know, Nick was right, it was frustration. It was absolutely frustration that governments were going one way and we as a community were going another. And drug law reform was certainly part of that. You know, we in the community, and I think most of my colleagues in Parliament, we know someone who has been affected by drugs. Many of us have had loved ones die from drug use. Certainly many of us have had loved ones affected in a negative way. And many of us have just had drugs and largely enjoyed them. Many of us probably still do have drugs and largely enjoy them. I would say that drugs got me elected, and I was on drugs when I was elected. No, that's the wrong way of saying that. Yes, I'll try and rephrase that. admitting that I use drugs and admitting that publicly helped me get elected, and I think it's something on days like Support Don't Punish, is days that we should remember that. To reduce the stigma, we need to come out of the closet and we need to talk about this. And this is what we did in the 80s and the 90s when we started wanting to change the laws around men who had sex with men. We had to come out in the closet. We had to talk about it. We had to talk about sex work. We had to talk about IV drug intravenous drug use. And we did, and we were brave, and we have to keep being brave, and we have to keep talking about it. So I've got 1 minute, and I am still optimistic, because today, on the day of Support Don't Punish, a bill that I did introduce, and despite what anyone else has to say, it with the support of people like Greg Denham, the support of most people in this room, and I can see some certain people, Cherie, just looking at you right there, the support of wonderful people in this room, Stefan, Sam, Tony, Michael, everyone, we managed to convince the government that this was the right thing to do. And this is what makes me optimistic, that I today went down and saw the progress of the supervised injecting centre and saw how it was happening and saw that this is the first, a very significant move in governments accepting that drug use is not a criminal issue. It is a health issue, and that we should be supporting people, not punishing people. Of course, with an election coming on, you're not going to hear a lot of that. And I implore you all to be careful with your vote, to be conscientious, to support the candidates and the people. And I mean, really support those candidates and people who will keep moving drug policy in the right direction. Canada has just done it in legalising drugs. New Zealand, of course, because they're always better than us, whether it's in rugby or marriage equality, they will come down that path. And we are seeing other jurisdictions, even Northern Territory, look at the Portuguese model of decriminalising use and possession, and Section 75 must go. But thank you all for having me here today. Thank you.
just want to reiterate those little baggies we had. We also had, like, on the back of them, the ingredients. That was the point where we were like, "What do you know what's in your baggie?" Well, we did, because we had the ingredients. It was they were mints. So it wasn't very exciting. I'd like to now, for our second last speaker, and again, supportdontpunish.org.au, we will not have much time for questions, so please, very succinct questions to supportdontpunish.org.au. Oh, and I think it's the jacket that does the game show host thing. It's Pop Shop jacket. Our second last speaker, Michael Short, who is chief editor of The Age. I actually don't have a full bio of you that is drug-related, but I know that you have covered... well, I was trying to make them all to do with Support Don't Punish, but I do know that you have written a number of feature articles on drug law reform and drug policies over a number of years. You're an award-winning journalist and an advocate for sensible reform. Michael, welcome to the stage.
Think of what a politician should be, Fiona, is that. Thank you for having me. I too would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of this land upon which we meet, the Gruenert people of the Kulin Nation, and pay respects to their elders, past, present, and any emerging here. When I was 15, and it's not a particularly great age for a lot of people, my best friend was called Greg. And he was the second of four siblings, and his father was an alcoholic who lost his job, and his mother was a teacher who was a beautifully gentle woman who got breast cancer. And Greg was kind of trying to keep the family together, and he had to leave the school that I was at because he was thrown out. He had some problems, and we went our different ways. And but we were very, very close. And the difficulties associated with his family, I think, helped lead him to perhaps use a hell of a lot more substances than he should have. And he took some acid one day, and he never came back from that trip. And Greg sat downstairs and poured petrol on himself, and it took 4 days for him to die in the hospital. And I thought about him probably every day for 15 to 20 years, and I still think of him. But Tony will talk to you presently about loss far better than I can. And there's no point me rehearsing tonight the overwhelming evidence based case for change. I think that we can all agree that's the evidence is in. The war on drugs is, I would argue, probably the greatest example in modern history of public policy failure at so many levels. The reason I write about change in this area and other areas is because I don't like ideology. And so I'd like to talk to you very, very quickly tonight about how to participate in the change that we all agree needs to come. I'm quite optimistic it will come. I think that the heroin injecting, safe injecting heroin and other substances space is just wonderful news, and I would imagine it will be as successful as others around the world and in King's Cross. The pill testing is another piece of evidence of change. The language that we use whilst seeking this change, I would urge to be sober, if I can use an expression. I'm sorry, I'm a bit stoned. I did my back on Sunday afternoon. Don't, dip, move, twist and lift the wood. Rookie mistake. So I'm on codeine. It's legal. It's an opioid. Well, related. Every 3 weeks in America, the equivalent number of people who died in 9/11 die of opioid overdose. This is legal. This, the question of substance use is there's such an arbitrary line between what's legal and what's not. It makes no sense. We know that. We also know through observation that we are all but one or two bad decisions or some really mongrel circumstances away from catastrophe. So the language to use here is about people. I'm an ambassador for the Asylum Seeker Resource Centre, a fantastic organisation that's done a whole lot of research into the way, into the language of politics and change. When you say asylum seekers, people have a different response to when you say people seeking asylum. We're not talking about drug users and drug addicts, we're talking about sons and friends. I have three kids. My wife calls me a hypocrite sometimes on this issue, and I don't think she's right, but she's sensitive to her conscience, perhaps. My kids are 25, so our kids are 25, 21, and 17. And yes, drugs are dangerous. Greg showed you that. Young developing minds are vulnerable to drugs. So what should we do? We should say this is an adult decision. You must not take this decision until you are old enough to do it with a semblance of safety. Most people, as Fiona and others have said, take drugs in the privacy of their own home without harm and with great pleasure. I want to be very, very quick. This is not a linear ideological scale issue. This isn't left or right. This isn't the providence of ideology. This is about leadership. And by leadership, I mean asking one simple question. Is this right? Where what is the case and what ought to be the case are together, then we should be radically conservative, all of us. We should fight against change. Where is and ought are nowhere near together. Drug policy in Australia being an example. We should fight for change. We should be progressive. But the left-right ideological scale doesn't work for this debate or any other political debate in this country because left-right ideology is outdated, imprecise, and does not appeal to the humanity that we share. It appeals to that separates us. The thing that shits me about people who identify on the left is that they feel that they have the moral high ground. The thing that shits me about the people who identify on the right is that they're into a free market for everything except ideas. And so if you disagree, you're at best misguided but well-meaning. Leave that territory and talk about people. Needless death. Harm minimisation is not an ideological concept. It is something that is driven by the evidence that we now have. We do need our politicians, we do need our lawmakers, they do important stuff when we can't do it for ourselves. This is one of the changes coming from the ground up. It's not they should do something. There is no them, there's us. There's Tony's son, there's my kids, there's you all are touched by this. Do it from the ground up. Support people like Fiona. Call your politicians. Write to the newspaper. And I would finally just like to say The Age. I'm the chief editorial writer of The Age and I'm a columnist, but I do not determine The Age's editorial policy. That is owned by the editor, and we discuss things on a daily basis and thrash out positions. I'm proud and pleased that The Age's position has been for some years, and I've been writing as editorials for some years, that change must come not because we want to encourage, condone, advocate for drug use. We want to advocate for life and for liberty and for families and for our individual freedom. And this has got to the point where, to borrow an Americanism, given that they gave us this stupid war, this is a no-brainer.
Our final speaker this evening has a few videos to show as well, and will be our longest speaker. And that's because Tony has quite a story to tell. Our final speaker is Tony Trimingham, who started Family Drug Support after receiving many phone calls from families suffering the effects of illicit drugs after he went public about the death of his son, Damien, from a heroin drug overdose. In 1998, he was made a founding member of the Australian National Council on Drugs, which was the Howard era initiative to bring together a conversation on drugs nationally. On Australia Day in 1999, he was awarded an Australian Day medallion by the Alcohol and Other Drugs Council of Australia for outstanding achievement in the reduction of alcohol and drug-related harm. The awards panel unanimously agreed that his personal commitment and hard work to support families of people with drug problems and to raise the profile of drug issues from a family perspective merited some measure of public acknowledgement of his exceptional achievements. In 2005, Tony was honoured with an Order of Australia Award for his work in the community, and in June 2008, Tony was a joint winner of the 2008 Prime Minister's Award for Excellence and Outstanding Commitment to Drug and Alcohol Endeavours. And Tony still runs Family Drug Support to this day, fds.org.au. Please give a warm welcome.
Thanks, everybody. I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet and pay respects to elders past, present and emerging. I want to acknowledge the person who supported me in my personal journey and my professional journey, my wife Sandra. And I want to acknowledge all the previous speakers and everybody here tonight. It's a great honour to be here. I want to thank the organisers for giving me a bit of extra time, and also to apologise to the other speakers. I feel quite privileged for that, but anyway, that's how it is. And when I was getting ready to come tonight, I said to Sandra, could I have my notebook? And she said, what's that? I said, they're my notes for tonight. She said, it's just a series of dates. I said, yeah, they're my notes. So when I was thinking about tonight, I thought, I won't write notes, I'll write dates, and I'll talk to those dates, because these dates are significant. They're significant for me, personally, and I'll explain why in a minute, but also significant because they signal important milestones in what we're talking about tonight. The way drug policy has ebbed and flowed, particularly over the time that I've been involved. But with me, everything starts with Damien. So my first slideshow is a short video of his life. It is a bit confronting, but everybody who sees it remembers it, so here we go.
When I need to feel you near me, I stand in this quiet place, with the silver light of countless stars falling on my face. Though it all shines so brightly, somehow it comforts me to know that some who burn the brightest died an eternity ago. But your light still shines, it's one small star to guide me and to help me hold back the dark. Your light still shining in my heart. I'm learning how to live without you, and I never thought I could. And even cherish the hearts and memories that can bring you back to life. Though some caress me gently and some cut me like a knife, but your light still shines. It's one small star to guide me and to help me hold back the dark. Your light still shining in my heart.
Venue was 20 years ago. The MC that night, it was a forum about drugs, was Peter Brock. And I shared the stage with two wonderful Victorian women, very brave women, Brenda Irwin and Steffi Wallace. And the three of us had lost people to drugs, lost children to drugs. So I'm really pleased to be back here tonight talking about this very important issue. The first date I've got on my list is June 1996. My life changed forever that day. Sandra and I had been overseas. We arrived home, got back to my house, and my son Damien was sitting on the doorstep. As soon as I saw him, I knew something was wrong. I walked up to him, he looked up at me and he said, "The shit's at the fan, Dad." I said, "What do you mean, what do you mean? Come inside." He blurted out that he'd been using heroin for 18 months. He and his girlfriend had spent $32,000 and they'd developed a $300 a day habit. They'd sold all their valuables, they'd used up all their savings, they'd stopped paying their bills, they'd borrowed money from just about everybody they could. That week, he'd lost his job, they'd been thrown out of the flat they lived in, And I guess he was at that point where the next step would have been crime, dealing, prostitution. I was overwhelmed with three emotions. Fear. And I realised I knew bugger all about this drug, except what I'd seen in media and read. I knew people died from it. Guilt. What had I done? How come this had happened to my son? I was a counsellor, I was a therapist. I was working with other people on their problems, and I couldn't see that this was happening in my own son. Guilt is very, very common for families. Was it because I got divorced? Was it because I spent too much time away from home? Grief. Damien was going to be an Olympic athlete. He was going to play football for Australia. He was going to be a leader. Everybody liked him. He had so many friends. Gone out the window. Those emotions filled me, but the one that poured out of me was the one that dads are really good at. Anger. I called him every name under the sun. I told him how stupid he was. I told him he'd wrecked his life. I really gave it to him. Just a little tip for those of you who are working with people who are angry. The anger is the masking emotion that masks those other three, fear, guilt, grief. Find out what the primary emotion is and work with that when somebody's angry. I sunk down into the chair, and then I got myself together. I stood up, I grabbed him by the collar, and I said, "We're going to beat this, son." I'd moved into the next stage in the process. Control. I was going to fix it. Masculine control. Fathers with problems solve them. So that was what I was determined to do. We've actually identified in talking to thousands of families that there's two types of control. There's masculine control, which is always fixing stuff. There's feminine control as well. Feminine control is like the juggler with all the balls in the air. Looking after the drug user, keeping them safe, rescuing them from their scrapes, colluding with them to hide stuff from the other partner who's going to get mad and throw them out. Then there's the partner to look after, keeping him calm. The other kids in the family with their needs. What about me? What about me? The household to run and maybe a job. So it's like a continuous juggling. That's feminine control. At its worst, it becomes over-responsibility and part of the problem. Control doesn't work. Whether it's masculine or feminine, it doesn't work. But I was into the masculine control that day. I got on the phone straight away. Where could I get help? So I rang the services that were there supposedly to give information and to give support. Every friggin' one of them said, "We can't help you. Go to the library. Go on the internet." I agree about treatment working. I agree that treatment services are wonderful. But in my time back then, what I got from treatment services was probably even worse. Because they said, first question, "How old's your son?" 21. "Sorry, can't talk to you. He'll have to ring us." Things have changed. Treatment services have changed. I don't think you'd get that response now. People would now ask you, how are you, how are you coping? Do you need support? What about your son, what's he doing? Can we do anything in the meantime? But back then it was very much that slam door. Talked to hundreds of families since then, of course, and another common thing is where do families go when they're in this position? So often they go to the people they think are going to be there to help them, the GP. GPs are part of the community, they have the same attitudes. 90% of them don't care, especially about drug users. So that door gets slammed. Oh, let's go to the priest then. Doesn't matter what religion. Same thing. A few people, in both doctors and priests, do care and do know about these things, but a lot don't. So then we talk to our friends, we talk to our workmates, and what message do we get from them? Oh my God, he's going to bleed you dry. You've got to throw him out, they've got to hit rock bottom. You've got to practice tough love. It's not what we want to hear. I rang my daughter. She said, send him to me. I'll do a cold turkey detox with him. So off he went to the Blue Mountains. 9 days, he withdrew from heroin. My daughter Gillian describes that as the worst 9 days of her life. She doesn't talk about it. But he was detoxed, and I thought, wow, weren't we lucky? We fixed it. We haven't fixed it. He stopped using heroin, mostly. But my God, he switched to alcohol in a big way. And at times when he was feeling black, he would use heroin. He wrote poetry, I found it after he died. Talk about heroin, an heroic drug that takes away all pain, physical, psychological, emotional. The most wonderful drug, named after the Greek god Hero. And then he'd write about a poison that seeped into his soul, into your body, and took your mind, spirit, and soul. He had this ambivalent attitude. The next date I've got down is February 24th, 1997. That was the day he died. I could talk for an hour about that day. There's a lot of things about that. 6 people in Sydney died that night. Despite the fact that he had ID on him, it took the police 3 days to notify me. When they did, they did it by telephone. I had to drive across Sydney from Chatswood to Glebe. The police, the young policewoman had said to me on the phone, we don't think it's your son, we just want to eliminate him from the possibilities. I walked into the Glebe Mall and there she was standing with a folder on her arm that said, Trimingham deceased. I knew it was him. They sent out a young woman. To me, she looked about 15, she was probably 25. She said, I'm here to counsel you. We sat down for an hour and I counseled her on how to counsel people. There's a lot of stuff I could tell you about that death. They did a post-mortem without my consent, without my knowledge. I didn't find out till 12 months later that when they did that post-mortem, they took all his organs. Brain, heart, liver, lungs, kidney, everything. Not to test them. They only need a little biopsy to test. They sent them to Sydney University for medical students to practice on. And that's what they were doing with overdose people back then. We got that stopped. A whistleblower rang me after I'd gone public and we got that stopped. Big funeral. Damon had lots of friends. Hundreds of people came into this little church in Willoughby and we said goodbye. And I was on a high. Seems hard to say that to you, actually, because it was a funeral. But there was so much support. He knew so many people. So many people liked him and talked about him. But as from that day forth, everybody went back to their lives. And the pain, I can't tell you, it was just excruciating. I used to dream of him being alive and then wake up to the nightmare of reality. And I was, you know, gradually going through a grieving process. I got very angry. I used to go down to Chatswood Police Station with his mobile phone records and said, here's the drug dealers. The policeman said to me one day, Mr. Trimingham, why do you keep coming here? What are you trying to do? So I turned away and I went on. And then, this is 1997. Heroin was really on the rise. Four people a day in Australia were dying. In Victoria, it was higher than the road toll. It was in the media all the time. And a couple of things happened politically. The ACT government proposed a trial of prescription heroin. They managed to get all the health and justice ministers of all the states and territories to agree to them doing this trial. They even got the federal minister, Dr. Michael Woolridge, to agree to it. I've been talking to people like Alex Wodak and other people who told me about drug law reform and prohibition and the war on drugs. And I was fired up about that. And so when I saw this thing happening in the ACT, I thought, fantastic. It's not going to bring Damien back, but it's going to save a lot of families. 2 days after it was announced that we're going ahead, the Prime Minister candidate, John Howard, is going to send the wrong message to young people about these drugs. Besides which, I will not allow heroin to be imported to be used in this trial. Of course, I discovered later that we are actually the biggest crop of opium in the world, in Tasmania, which we export for legal opiates. That was the end of that. The New South Wales government had conducted a 4-year police royal commission into police corruption. Yeah, of course, the police corruption was all tied up with the drug trade. But in that inquiry, it actually took evidence from people in King's Cross about so-called shooting galleries, where you go to a brothel, pay $20, 15 minutes, shoot up. If you didn't come out in your allotted 10 minutes, the brothel owner would open the door and often find people overdosed, and lives were saved. So Justice Wood said, we need these. We have to have them. But they should be not run by the sex industry and the criminals. It should be a medical facility. The New South Wales government did what most governments do, and they have something that they are scared about. They called an inquiry. And a parliamentary committee took evidence. I've got that report on my desk. It's a thick report. There's no negatives in that report. They went to Europe, they looked at them, they took evidence from people like me. The only couple of things that were against it were a few religious people and a few moral people and their opinions. But they went to water on it. So in my next date, I've got March 1998, I went to Geneva. I went to the harm reduction conference, but I went to look at facilities for dispensing heroin and injecting facilities. And I went thinking that if I saw things there that were negative, I would change my mind. I would come back and I would say, I've been, I don't like what I've seen. Perhaps we need to go back to the old ways. When I got to Switzerland, I couldn't believe it. It wasn't just what was going on in the rooms and how humanely they were treating people. You could go and get a cup of tea, you could get a bowl of soup, you could have somebody to talk to, they showed videos. But it wasn't that that impressed me, it was the way the locals accepted it. These facilities were in commercial centres, they were in residential centres, they were in business centres. And nobody batted an eyelid. So I came back empowered, thinking this is what we've got to do. So some of us, Alex Hordak, Reverend Bill Cruz, a number of other people, we started having secret meetings. And we were plotting to open an injecting facility. And it all kind of got really powerful when the guy who was running the Wayside Chapel in King's Cross said, you can use the church. We talked to police. We talked to the DPP, Director of Public Prosecutions, and we talked to the public defender. We got legal advice. We even talked to a couple of politicians quietly. And we opened the Torrens Room, that we called in King's Cross, in the Wayside Chapel in January 1999. My God, did that hit the media. We were on the news every day. We were in the newspapers every day. We brought out the enemy, of course. I remember one day, Fred Nile, Normie Rowe, and Tony Wood turning up at the chapel demanding that it be closed down. Yeah, we got a lot of opposition. The police raided it, arrested the minister and three drug users. But we made our point. Bob Carr called a drug summit. On the agenda were injecting facilities. We lobbied the politicians. The Labour Party came on side, and some brave people from the coalition also voted for the recommendations. Thursday night, out of a week of talking about this, was the day that all the recommendations went to the drug summit delegates. The injecting centre got up. We also won the vote on legalising or decriminalising marijuana. And we also got agreement to get rid of the Self-Administration Act. Prescription heroin was one of the ones as well. The Labour Party went to water on that one. So that one didn't get up. Then the three that had gone up, got up, had to go to Parliament. And again, the Labour Party wimped out on decriminalising cannabis and the self-administration. But they persevered with the injecting centre. Those of us who were there that day thought that was the start of the dominoes falling. How disappointed we were. 20 years later, where are we? Well, we got another one in Victoria. About time. Steve Brax had gone to an election promising 6 injecting centres in Victoria. He beat Jeff Kennett in that election. Everybody said he couldn't win. He won that election. And the first thing he did was abandon the injecting facilities for Victoria. So 20 years later, you're finally getting them. It's time. We all got off our asses and started again. So, you know, following on what others have said tonight, we need to talk to our politicians. Everybody in this room could make 2 appointments, one with your federal member and one with your state member, and tell them that this needs to change. Write letters to newspapers. Do a bit of civil disobedience. I mean it. And we need young people. I mean, I'm so glad. So it's so good to see the students for sensible drug policy here, because you are the ones who have to take this forward. I don't think I'm going to see dramatic change in my life, but it will come. Only if you do it, though. Only if you get out there and mobilise and get the community on side and educate them about this. Damien's death is my family's tragedy. That will never go away. The burning pain of the first few years has gone now for me. What I have now is the what might have beens, the missed conversations, seeing him grow and get a career or get married and have kids, and that's what the pain is now for me. And that pain will be with me till the day that I die. My relationship with him won't end until the day I die. A bigger tragedy for Australia, though, is that since he died in February 1997, 20,000 Australians have died from drugs. 20,000! In America, it's 20,000 a week. But Australia, we've lost 20,000. Mostly between the ages of 14 and 40. If people were dying for any other cause, there'd be an outcry and there'd be action. I'm just going to finish with another slideshow and show you just about 35 of that 20,000. These are people who we've lost in the time since Damien died. And it's just 35 out of 20,000. Thank you.
Can't wait to